Hey everybody, welcome to a special episode of Professional Musicians React. Today we are going to dive into one instrument and one musician that changed the game. This is James Jamerson's bass performance in Marvin Gaye's What's Going On.
Musicians React.
Hey, hey, hey.
Hey, what's up now?
Brother, what's up?
This is a good big party, man.
Yeah, brother,
like,
stop right on.
Their time.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer.
Backbeats in the song sound like someone's playing racquetball.
Yeah.
You know we've got to find a way to bring some love and get here today. Oh. Picket lines and picket signs. Punish me
sister.
With brutality
sister.
Talk to me
sister.
So you can see
sister.
Oh, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
What's going on?
Yeah, what's going on?
What's going on? Fuck, dude.
Sick.
James,
I mean,
Jamerson.
I have so much. Yeah, I mean, that's like, this is like one of the, this song is like one of the most important electric bass performances
of
in
all
like the history of the instrument.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. There's like this incredible story about this tune where apparently like they were trying to find him to play bass on this and he was like passed out drunk and recorded the whole thing in one take on his like
on his back. Yeah.
That's what is on this track.
That's what's on the record. Yeah.
Is that true?
I saw it in a documentary.
It's as true as anything else we've said so far today.
Yeah. You know, this isn't
we'll find out in the comments,
okay? Yeah. Yeah, this is the...
Read below to find out if anything we said
was true.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, there's so much I could say even before about the song, just about like James Jamerson as an instrumentalist. I mean, it's crazy, like, because I have a transcription of this tune. Like, there's this great book called Standing in the Shadows of Motown, which is all about the life of James Jamerson for people who don't know like about the history of like the Motown session band and stuff like that. It was like the same group of guys who played on like every hit Motown song. And James Jamerson was the bassist most of the time. And the way he played, he played everything with one finger. So most people play bass with two fingers like this. And he was an upright bass player, a jazz guy. So he played and if you watch upright bass players, because the instruments had a little bit of an angle, they always play like that.
Mm.
So he always played with one finger pointing down that way. And if you listen to like the bass line, because there are a lot of 16th note subdivisions, the boom. There's like this little shortness in some of the articulations as he's changing strings that you literally can't get any other way.
Two fingers.
Like if you're playing with two fingers, you hit it right on and you're saying there's a little bit of a pause because he's using the same finger.
Exactly. So if you play like...
Oh.
Right, you can hear it. But if I play it with two fingers...
Now you're on the fucking grid. Now you're a metronome.
It's really legato.
Legato is a term that refers to the length of a note being played or sung by a musician. So legato notes are sung or played with a long release time as opposed to staccato notes, which are short.
The thing that's so cool about him is like, I almost consider him like the Bach of electric bass in some sense.
Yeah,
because like everything he came up with, and he was improvising like, you know, a large portion of what he was playing. There's some composed parts, but most of what he was doing was kind of spontaneously composing off the top of his head. And he always came up with these bass lines that were like perfect counterpoint to the melody.
Perfect melodies.
Yeah.
Jack Stratton makes these videos where he visualizes James Jamerson bass lines.
Yeah, they're amazing.
They're perfect melody. Yeah. I mean,
can you just real quick, some other tracks I might know. I've never heard of him, but
Bernadette. He played on Ain't No Mountain High Enough.
Ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby.
Like every famous Motown song pretty much is Jamerson. He played on
Jackson 5.
No, I don't think he, well, which one?
I don't know.
He plays the Jackson 5 one. I know of him is that tune Darling Dear, the It's like the baddest Jamerson shit ever. He played on For Once in My Life.
For once in my life, I have someone who needs me, someone I've needed so long.
That kind of stuff. That's all Jamerson.
Was there like the party sound in the background the entire track?
Pretty much.
Yeah. It sounds like he finished the track. He's like, all right, we need more vibe. And he called his friends over. He's like, can you guys just kind of hang out?
We could do keyboards, or we could have a low-key rager.
Yeah, we got one track left. Should we do party or keyboards? Let's do the party.
the changes.
Yeah.
Just that.
So classic.
Going to that.
The minor four.
Minor four, where it just feels like.
And then it hangs there for eight bars or something.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
And then
B sus.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
That's the one.
Yeah. And the string writing is perfect.
It's so good. One of my favorite things in the horn, the string part and horn parts at the end is there's like this little figure that like. Then it waits a long time to hit the G. And it sort of implies like a G major sound over that A minor chord.
Interesting.
And I love when people voice things like that. And you hear it a lot in 70s soul music where they'll write
like
different,
that kind of thing.
But you still hear the third in it. So it's like you kind of like make whatever part you're writing, like some of the counter lines are often made out of different triads that work over the chord you're doing. And it's like such a beautiful, simple way to make complex sounds out of simple ingredients.
Triad pairs, bro.
I love triad pairs.
I knew it. I feel like this is one of the first times I've heard the signature like Marvin thing of there's two Marvins singing.
War is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
Just loosely, like around each other.
Oh, is that it's him?
It's kind of like what happens with the clav in Superstition, where like
totally.
Very superstitious.
You don't process when you just hear it on one speaker, like which guy is singing the part that you think of as the melody normally, but he like did a pass and then just did another pass and he was just like, all right, put them both in.
Yeah.
Kind of what it sounds
funny,
like.
I did that exactly. I made Antoine Stanley, not made, but Antoine Stanley
forced.
Sang.
I forced
Antoine Stanley to sing the liner notes on the last song of my album is liner notes and Antoine sang it and he did that. He sent me two tracks and I was like, oh, it's just
put
good if they're
in.
Both there, hard panned, yeah.
The other thing that's always so crazy to me is the racquetball.
Father, we don't need to.
Which sounds like they did a conga pass, and then there's a drum pass, and then it just sounds like there's a single like conga that's doubling the snare.
In the middle, yep.
Yeah, and not all of the time, but it just sounds like some guys are playing racquetball in the next room.
It's also cool too, like speaking of the percussion on this one, like a lot of Al Green tunes are like this too, where if you remove the percussion, the groove is not the same. Like you lose all the forward momentum. Like if you play, people play this tune a lot at cover gigs and stuff. And it never really sounds like the record. And I think part of the reason it has to do with the fact that there's almost never a percussion when people playing it. People are trying to cop it all on the drum kit and the vibe is totally different.
Did you hear, I want to do one more pass. I heard the bass cut out for a bar. Did you hear that?
It does not.
Okay,
someone check Jack's headphones, please.
Let me hear his phone.
There's far too many of you dying.
Right there.
Now that he's just holding onto a note. So what he's playing is. Bing, do, do,
do, do, do, do, do. So yeah,
the thing about it is, the Fender basses at that time had mutes on the bridge, so the decay of the note isn't as long as the basses that don't have it.
So he's just not playing in those couple beats.
He's just holding out a note.
Too many of you die.
Yeah.
The other thing that's cool to think about that I feel like people don't realize a lot of the time is how new the instrument was. Do you know what I mean? Like this instrument, like this didn't exist. So like now there's people that have been playing bass their whole lives, you know, like 20 years, 30, 40 years. But like at the end, like all these people were innovating. Like these were brand new instruments.
Exactly.
That, like they were just figuring out how to.
Yeah.
And James Jamerson was just like the first guy to like invent this whole style of bass playing.
That's the thing too. It's like when you listen to this, you're like, oh, this is R&B bass playing, but it wasn't R&B.
It didn't exist.
It didn't exist before Jamerson. Yeah, that's the thing. It's like every bass player in the world copies this guy. Right. Like he was Paul McCartney's favorite bass player, I think. It's what I heard. But it makes sense. He's in.
Let us know in the comments.
Let us know in the comments. Yeah. He is. Paul McCartney does write one of the forewords in the transcription book about Jamerson, though. Mm. And if you listen to Paul McCartney bass lines, it's like the non improvised version
of Jamerson
for the Beatles.
Mm. Yeah.
His style of bass playing for Motown was one of my major influences when I was learning electric bass. And I know that a lot of the people who are playing and demonstrating his technique on this tape. I've also been influenced by him.
Jaco Pistorius, like if you listen to all of Jaco's, like the... It's like Jamerson with two fingers.
Mm.
You know, I mean, it's like every... This is just like the DNA of the bass guitar. To bring some understanding
here today. And like you see them playing them early on, like, and they're all holding them like real slanted because they're used to playing upright basses.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
It's just so kind of, sick.
We take it for granted that like, yeah, that's a bass. It's always existed. But can you imagine like growing up and then when you're 15 or something, this thing just appears. It's just like this new, you know, it's like an OP1 or, you know what I mean? It's just like, whoa, upright bass. That's, I mean, an electric bass. That's cool.
Sick as fuck, dude.
We're going to wrap it up there. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to Musicians React. We're coming out with weekly videos, so if you like this, subscribe and you'll see more. Let us know what we should talk about next in the comments below, if there's a song that you like or if there's music or an artist or whatever it is, and you'd like us to talk about it or pick it apart or analyze it. Let us know in the comments below, and we will see you next week. Adios.